Okay. This way I can hit arrow keys, I guess. So basically, my name is Mina Loomis, and my husband Robert Norris is in the back of the room. And we, this site and our house is about 8 blocks from here, down near 45th and Vernon. We've been in Austin since the late 1970s. I was born here, but I grew up in Houston. Robert's family's got family from the Hill Country and all over South Texas. But we ended up purchasing this house in 1990. Robert works for the state, so he goes to the office every day. And I used to work for Texas Legal Services Center, and then I quit because I didn't want to do that anymore, and our kids needed more attention. So that ended my career, and so now I fiddle with things like this. Because they became very large and abandoned us. So that's kind of a little bit of background. So this house, not this, what you're seeing here, but...
You have renovated your main house,
yeah, and
right?
So...
And you've done a good job of greenifying that.
This is kind of some pictures of the yard and the house, the back of the house. This house was built in 1937. It was updated in the mid-80s during the boom. We bought it in 90 during the bust. And we put the dormers on in 94. So that's the, because the kids were getting bigger and we wanted a second bathroom, so we put a bathroom in there and some rooms. We tried to garden in the back, and I've had good gardens elsewhere lots of times, but this particular piece of ground, just crop failure. So who knows what's the matter with the soil in there? Probably tree roots and old, who knows, you know, over the generations what may have been dumped there. So I'm trying to rehabilitate it gradually. These pictures are from just before we started the more recent changes. So that's looking towards the back garden area where my sons are trying to clear it out. And this half pipe was there for a little while. Then I had him tear it apart. The back of the house, you can see, was experiencing a lot of rot. And that became an even bigger project. But that's not the subject tonight.
Did you mention what it was that originally prompted you to decide on a cottage?
We're getting there.
Okay.
So we're kind of bad at home maintenance. We tried with limited money. It took us about 2 years to paint the outside of the house. We hired someone to paint the window sashes. Tackling that ourselves would have had pitiful results. So that gives you kind of an idea of, you know, I'm kind of a tinkerer and we kind of work at it, but our threshold is pretty high for getting some of this stuff done. So we're not like your builder type people, really. We got the roof fixed, and you can see in the right-hand picture the metal roof, and it's a little hard to see in this picture, but there's the ventilation layer in there. And in 2006, Gail designed this roof for us to try to reduce the amount of heat buildup upstairs, so that was a big help. The front porch used to be it didn't used to extend out in front of the roof line there. It was just concrete slab, and I wanted to extend it, and Frank Meyer, who is one of the local natural builders, advised me we figured out a way that I could do it without pouring concrete, involving stacking rocks and holes in the ground and some things like that. So I did that by hand by myself, which I was pretty proud of myself for that. So we did that. And that kind of, but that whole process, I kind of got started. I was going to Straw Bale, the old SBAT meetings, and then I started to come to Sustainable Building Coalition, which became Design, Build, Live. And I started going to I'd see the straw bale displays like at the fairs and stuff where you'd see stuff, and that was all, you know, I kind of got this bug in the back of my mind about some things that might be cool to do. There was this meeting, and it was over at Casa de Luz, and somehow I was sitting at this table with some people, and they said, well, we need somebody to do the newsletter, and I went, well, newsletters are easy, and they said, okay, well, you can. So I ended up being a Sustainable Building Coalition volunteer without really having gone out to do that evening. And then I decided to go to a weekend straw bale workshop, wall raising out in Dripping Springs, and that was taught by the Clint and Joe Wilhelm, which are, I think they're retired now, but and that was really fun. So I went, well, I want to do more with this. And I figured I was only going to have one shot at building anything, so we're going to see how good it could be. In 2008, DBL put on a roundwood workshop. Wrong slide. Where am I? Anyway. There. DBL put on a roundwood workshop taught by Frank to add a trellis to the front porch. So there's Frank and a whole bunch of people, including, I think, Gail in the background in her red shirt. And we were peeling these juniper posts that Frank had gone out to somebody's property that they wanted them cleared. And he'd picked out the exact right ones he wanted, and so he did this design, and he taught us all how to do it, and it was really, really fun, and we worked at it all evening, all weekend, and so that was that, and that trellis, you'll see another picture of it later, it has worked out extremely well. So that was our first adventure.
All covered with vines now, is it?
I'm sorry?
It's all covered with
it
vines.
Is, that Banksia roses, they're very aggressive, so it's all covered. It's got some of that, those little fungal fruiting bodies in it too, but because it keeps it kind of damp in there, but it's still quite sturdy, you can still walk around on it, so should be fine. So then Robert received an inheritance in 2009, and we decided to move forward before we frittered it completely away, or our kids got it for frittering. And so Gail drew this design for us, and she offered me some round, sort of rounded hobbit house kind of shapes for the cottage, but the space, I don't know if you remember looking at the earlier picture, but the space back in there is, it's very rectangular all the way around in a small back, you know, city backyard, so we didn't want to kind of clash with that. So we felt like a rectangular would be better. And I got this one out of order. But there were some other reasons behind all of this. Robert wanted a fireplace. That's our living room and dining room, two different directions. It's narrow, it's not very big, no room for a fireplace in there. The house line is 2 feet from the property line, so it's grandfathered, but there's no room over there. So it was like there was no putting a fireplace in the house, wasn't gonna happen. Only guest space was a bunk bed and a room full of storage, bathroom and kitchen in the back of the house, full of rot and falling apart. We don't want to move away if later we end up in a wheelchair or have other accessibility needs, and Robert wanted a fireplace. So that was kind of where we were going with, okay, we're going to fix the house and we're going to get this cottage for guests and other things. So this is the design that she drew, and she had permaculture drainage, and she told me how the house needed to be redone, and I had some sketches, and she completely said, no, you can't, you don't want to do that, you want to do it this way, and it was really fun. So we ended up with, so the the back rectangle there is, the gray one is the roof line of the cottage, and then the little other green rectangle is a little breezeway, and then the other one at the bottom is the existing garage. And then on the back of the house, which we're not talking about tonight, was the rest of it. So so we decided to get all of that fixed in one process, but we were going to have to vacate most of the house in order to do this, the house part. So we thought, well, we'll do the cottage first and then we'll go live there, which was actually turned out really nice. So where was I? We kind of hoped the cottage could be a kind of a demonstration of this process by somebody who's not a builder or out in the country somewhere or doing it all by themselves. And so here we are right smack in the middle of the city and we want to do this thing. We wanted to use as much as we could of salvage and local materials and stone and wood and cob and lots of DIY. Why cob instead of straw bale? That question came up earlier. And really, it was because of the amount of space that we had, because straw bale is like your walls are this thick. And we only, the only way we figured that we could probably do this was to do it as an accessory building, which is like, it's like where people want to put up a shed or a gazebo or something like that. So it's, if it's under 200 square feet exterior footprint, then you don't have to have a building permit for it. You still have to have the technical permits if you want plumbing or you want electricity or those still have to be permitted because that's a safety issue. But you don't have to have a building permit, which means that you can do things like have a loft with a ladder instead of a proper stairway, and you don't have to worry about all those things. So
it will save you money and time.
Yeah. So we wanted to be sure that it was less than that. Cobb, the walls were able to be only 12 inches thick instead of the wider bale. And 12 inches is sturdy enough with Cobb. So that was the answer to that question. Am I doing okay time-wise? Am I running on too much? Okay. So in fall of 2009, I went to a week-long Cobb building workshop out in Bastrop taught by Christina Ott. And it was lots of fun and we learned a lot, and that it rained all week and that made it kind of a hassle. And for all the simplicity of clay and sand and straw, making a durable modern building out of it is complicated. The owner of that project wanted it built too fast in wet weather, and the wall that we raised, actually the next week it kind of failed and they had to come back in there with some other people and rebuild it. But it wasn't because either of Christina's teaching or our efforts, it was because he was saying throw it on too fast and it doesn't have time to set up and it slumps, and Kirby will go into more of that stuff because he was real good at that.
What are those balls at Christina's feet there?
Cob balls. Cobs, yes. So the word cob is the old English word for loaf. So when they made cob, it was because they were making these balls that were, and the same word was used for a loaf of bread and for these lumps of building mass that they used to put into the walls.
When you say it couldn't be too fast, what do you mean by that?
It needs to set up. As you go around each layer, it needs to set up about, you can do about 6 inches a day, and if you go much faster than that, especially in wet weather, but generally, then
There's not enough time allowed to compact.
It doesn't stabilize enough, it doesn't dry. It does, you don't want it completely dried out, but you don't want it to be too wet. Or because if you get too much wet on, you can imagine it just kind of starts to slump down and it loses its integrity. So that's what happened to that building. And then later they fixed it and they built it all up, and then it burned up in 2011 in the fire. So, darn. I'm sorry? Well, the Cobb didn't, but the rest of the building, they had a second story that was wood on top of it. And so it that Craig guy.
Oh, okay. Right.
The guru guy. Mm-hmm. He was kind of irritating, but it was nice that he did that. So we decided, okay, well, if we're going to do this, we're going to do some design, build, live workshops. So we start with a list of workshops that we planned with the permaculture and site planning, rubble trench foundation, cob walls, earthen floor, exterior lime plaster, and the living roof. Of those, the living roof one has not yet been done. We haven't done anything with that roof, but the rest of it. So that's kind of like the first workshop there. This is the site before we started, February 2010. So you see the beat up old rotten garage back there and nothing else really much left. We did tend to have water problems going back there where it's all brown in there. Towards the back, heavy rain events, we would pool up back there because our neighbors built up the back and the water doesn't flow down to Shoal Creek like it should. So there's our first workshop taught by Kirby. Permaculture, site, drainage, rain gardens, berms. Kirby and Gail, March 2010. So that's when we kind of broke ground, so to speak, on the whole thing. We didn't get to the cottage foundation yet.
How much site prep, foundation prep for the cottage did we do at that workshop?
Not any, really.
No.
It was mapped out, but we didn't do any of that. We just did the rain gardens and the berms and some of the planting. And talked, we did a lot about how to measure the slope and how to
drainage.
Yeah, how to direct the drainage, how to make the water soak in.
Kirby improved the soil somewhat.
Yep. Plants to use, soil improvements to use, that kind of stuff. Good stuff. Stuff you want to do before you build, really. Then it rained a lot, but look, we caught the water. And Gail and I came in after that workshop and we put the walkway in there. And Kirby told us that he didn't think that decomposed granite that we bedded that in was going to hold, but it has. The weeds come up in it, but it's been really stable. It's still there. It's been messed with some because we've changed some things, but So from my experience in all of this process, I mean, I can tell you what we did, but we weren't sure what the timeline was going to be. Workshops take time. I have a lot of other commitments. I manage my day job kind of is that I'm a volunteer that I manage the backpacking for the Campfire Kids locally. That it takes a fair amount of time. Robert goes to work the office every day. We go on longer trips sometimes, so it's not like we were gonna set ourselves up to, we were not gonna do this full time. I did a lot of running around collecting materials, river gravel, crushed granite, limestone. Some of it we had delivered in giant trucks, some of it I went to pick up. We bought a little used truck for this. We figured we could sell it after the whole thing was done. Well, my older son took care of that. But that was the idea. It did come in handy. We had little idea either of costs or work involved. So it's like we didn't have, okay, it's going to cost this much and we have an estimate and all these things. We didn't do any of that, because nobody knew how it was gonna go. So we said, well, this is an experiment. Gail recruited Kirby for the first workshop. Back there, the site characteristics, it had one hose bib and there was one wire of electricity to the garage that we had done with the project in 94. So that was all the infrastructure we had back there. No sewer line back there. We had the 10-foot back easement to work with and the 5-foot side setback. Not sure whether the garage was salvageable. So we did pay a lot of attention to the water. Our lot slopes towards the creek. Covered that. It was kind of fun building the walkway, really. So that's where we started on the foundation. And that's our younger son and two of his friends, and I hired them to dig out that trench and move the dirt, and it all went over there, and then we made another berm along that side. Later our neighbor over there worried about soil washing through the fence, so last year we ended up digging a narrow trench between the berm and the fence, so and laying a bunch of bamboo in it so she wouldn't worry so much anymore. So Gail and Kirby taught the Rubble Trench Foundation workshop, and Kirby will probably tell you more about that, but Gail was the one that said, well, that's what you want because it drains and it adjusts if the ground moves and good stuff. So I wasn't even at that workshop because I had a backpacking trip to lead that weekend. Between the March workshop and this one in May, we went to the Grand Canyon, this kind of distraction, you know, do it yourself. Things take a long time when you have that kind of distraction. So owner experience again. But that foundation is still functioning very well. This here, where we trenched that drain out, that was an unfinished loose end. It is still an unfinished loose end.
But it's working.
It is, you know, it's working. The Rubble Trench Foundation is working. The water never comes up any. It does fill up with water, but it doesn't come up past the bottom of the bond beam. So we have the building has been there now for several years, and it has not cracked or fallen down, which is good. So, concrete foundation beam and 2 layers of limestone. We're in August now. So, give you an idea. Kirby's crew did all of this. I had no idea how to do any of it. Don't remember why it took August to do this part, but I did have at least one Campfire Mountain trip early in the summer, and Kirby probably had other jobs to finish. We developed a pattern of working around everybody's schedule.
Thanks, Village.
Really? Where are we? So, gathering materials. Fall 2010. 12 yards of sand, 10 yards of yellow clay from dripping springs, 15 bales of wheat straw. Good stuff. The Rumford fireplace was recommended by Gail. A gentleman by the name of Lee Bones specializes in building these. The idea is that it's supposed to reflect, it's small, but it's supposed to reflect, it's angled to reflect the heat out into the room. So he would come back at each stage of the process. Get that another piece of it built. So this was the sand, and the clay was under the big billboard tarp, and I drove down to Schertz and got 15 bales of hay, or straw rather. I never say hay because it's never hay. Completely different animal. But the straw is the stems of the dried plant, in this case wheat. Hay is leaves, and you don't want leaves, they're too nutritious. The stems is just what's left from the plants through it. They had saved, usually you want to get bales in the spring, but they had saved some of these to sell for Halloween decorations, so they had some available. And that was all we needed, really. We had a little bit left over. So we got the fireplace started, and we were experimenting with cob mixes with Gail's guidance, mixing by hand and foot. Gail got the honor of smushing the first cobs into the wall just before the cob workshop, which we had next. Foot and tarp mixing, hoe and plywood mixing, first row around the foundation. The group activity was mostly the mixing with the tarp and the feet and laying it on the wall and moving all the materials around, and we did the cob chain where you toss the balls from where you made them to down to the wall, and it was all really fun. Our expert builders preferred to use the hoe and plywood mixing rather than the feet, and they were pretty fast at it. So
all done. A reminder: in the fall and the winter, not in the dead of July and August.
No, this was in the fall. So the cob workshop also covered door and window bucks, spine and ribs. So that's that where you see us, me and Gail over there making those lumps in there. It's a way of setting it up on the last cob that you lay in on a particular day, and it allows it to dry out a little bit more, and it allows a structure to help you key in the next day. To it, and then the next day you spray water on it to get it going again. And they had embedded some rebar, you can see that down there on the lower left picture, into the concrete to tie into the cob. We fiddled with the electrical chase, how to do that for a while, because we wanted to come back in there and be able to update technology if we needed to. I don't know how that's going to work out, but if you have expert carpenters put in your baseboard on that kind of thing, find out if they're going to use square drive screws before you try to take it apart with something else. It works really well. It holds it really tight. So, we got snow in February. We kept cobbing. I had a couple friends come over. Lee added more to the fireplace. I was mostly it was me. I could do about two tarps of cob a day and go out there and lay it in. And Robert has a lot of work to do at the office and some back issues, so we didn't have him working on that. All foot and tarp mixed. At this rate, the walls were going to take to get forever, not even counting carpentry and other stuff. So reality strikes. We got up to about the bottom of the windows, but our walls were looking kind of lumpy. So then Kirby became available. I know. Whatever other thing he was working on settled down. Yay. He advertised on the Permi list and found some folks who wanted cob experience at an hourly wage. Bunches of folks came in, and the walls got nice and straight, and they worked fast, and lots of different people came to help during the spring of 2011, and I settled into writing checks. So that's how, but it came up in about 5 weeks after that, so that was cool. And then we got into the serious carpentry part. Roundwood Eastern Red Cedar from Wamplers in Bastrop, ridge beam, lintels, loft joists, yellow pine for strength. We had visitors sometimes. And upper framing, roof tie-ins. I'm not going to go a lot into this because I'm not the expert. Dead men, other details. I was watching running errands and backseat driving. Ridge beam day. I was going to have a video for this, but I didn't figure out how to work it, so too bad. 22 feet long, 8 inch by 14 inch eastern red cedar from somewhere over there where Romplers get stuff from, not too far away. They got all this rigging and tackle set up, and it took a whole bunch of people, and I stayed out of the way and took pictures.
What's the ballpark of what a beam like that would run, y'all?
I don't know what I paid for it, a bunch of money. Yeah.
Okay. And it was custom built, right?
Mm-hmm.
By Romplers.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Why not bring in heavy equipment to do that? Well, we didn't have access for one thing, and I don't know what it would have cost. And these guys just, it was like magic what they, I mean, it was like mechanical, but it was like, wow, people can just do that with their hands and feet and a few ropes and blocks and ladders and things and enough people. It was really cool. Well-earned beer after a big day.
So your roof sits right on your cob walls. It's not, there's no
yeah.
There's no posting.
No. See, that's
the structure is the cob.
It's just the little beam there and the those all thread tie-ins. Yep.
So the rafters don't bear directly on the cob.
No, they're on a piece of some wood that's sitting on the cob, but it doesn't have a concrete top beam. So we had a site visit. That was fun. And we got some rafters. See there, so you can see in that lower left picture how that's kind of, then they were cobbing up between the rafters there to do the ends. Little picture of what the inside looked at that stage, looked like. And it rained even. We're getting there. We're getting this thing built. Limestone threshold, which I went out to, we got that limestone, getting all that limestone at Whittlesey, because that's just that native Texas limestone, and you can go out and you can pick what you want. Roof decking, we had that, did the ventilation layer again like we did at the house. This was one of the mistakes that we made, and I won't go into a lot of details, but we should have, before we put that roof decking on there, we should have laid in our ventilation barrier between the rafters and the wood deck, vapor barrier, whatever it is, the air infiltration barrier there between that, and we ended up having to do some extra stuff later in insulating the roof after that, which, you know, you figured it out later. Too bad. The pros carried on without me getting all of that on. I went with the Campfire Kids to the Guadalupe Mountains and took this picture on the lower right of the stone Pratt Cabin in McKittrick Canyon with the whole roof made out of local stone, which was really cool looking. But they unloaded all that metal roofing and did all that roofing themselves. They didn't go out and get another roofer to do it. So we loved the look of the underside of the roof decking, but we couldn't keep it exposed and have any insulation up there, so too bad. But you can still see it on the eaves. The electrician and the electrical inspector came and went. The electrical was the only permit that we needed. Electricians are expensive. We worried that the electrical inspector with the city would find some broken rule regarding the size or nature of the building, but he didn't. He really liked it a lot. He went, this is so cool in here. I really like this. So that was nice. And then we did, I had just wanted to do that. That's that kind of cane fencing that you get at the garden store that's in the ceiling. And so these guys did a real pretty job of laying everything in. So where was I on here? I don't know. I missed something.
Don't forget the shredded denim.
Oh, yeah, well, that's what we insulated it with. I didn't have any pictures of that, so I was, but it was, we used that shredded denim insulation stuff.
Is that stuffed in by hand? Or
no, it's in bats.
It's in bats, all right.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah. So. So there we have putting in the loft and where the fireplace was, loft, scratch coat, plaster, electricity. Earthen floor workshop. Recipes written on 2x4s, people pounding it down, gravel base, cob, and then the red clay that we got from over by Kirby's by Dale. Red clay over there. They cut out this pretty piece of limestone for the hearth.
How long for the earthen floor?
I'm sorry?
How long did it take to install the whole earthen floor?
Well, the workshop, the main layers of it went in on that one workshop, which was a weekend, but then y'all worked for a few more days on the floor, I think.
A week, maybe.
Yeah.
A week, maybe.
And then I oiled it, and that's another story I'll get to in a minute. We're almost done here.
Total elapsed time on an earthen floor is a long time.
Yeah, because you got to let stuff dry.
Like with all natural building, it's all about timing and drying and doing things in the right sequence and everything. So a lot of the time is waiting. With the earth floor, it's waiting for it to dry and waiting for the layer upon layer of oil to dry. So it's a very long.
It's kind
process,
of a curing process.
Yeah.
And so like when they came in with that red clay, they didn't do that right after the workshop. They did it like they let the cob dry first, and then they did that. Gail brought in Jim Halleck and crew to prepare and teach the exterior lime plaster workshop. We chopped and soaked prickly pear cactus to make slime for the binder and used the same yellow clay as the rest of the building and lime and sand.
So, and how long did we slake that lime before?
I don't remember. Y'all know those things. I forgot. Yeah, a while. Uh-huh. After the workshop, the finish on two sides still needed to be done, so Norm Ballinger came and did those later in the week. Then it was my job to mist the walls every day for a long time so it would dry slowly and get really hard. Gail thought we'd be needing to whitewash it for protection from the elements, but we liked the pretty pinkish color from the sand, so we held off. After 5 years, the plaster is still as good as new. So, good for it. Kirby and Matt finished the top layer of floor, built the breezeway, partly with wood salvaged from the deck off the back of the house, which we were starting to take apart, repaired and painted the garage walls, which we decided to save. And I was spreading boiled linseed oil on the floor eventually, and until it stopped soaking in. Kirby built that pretty Kiva ladder. The wheat from the straw came up by the side of the house, and so we had a crop of wheat the next year. Spring 2012, we moved into the cottage because we put an outdoor, because of the ripping off the back of the house. So we put an outdoor kitchen in the breezeway, and we lived there the whole next year. While Lee McKenzie, who had found out we had met him because he came to the rubble trench workshop, and Gail said, try that. And I asked Kirby and a couple of other people about, I asked Bill Moore about this, and Kirby was busy, and Bill said he wouldn't touch this thing with a 10-foot pole. And Lee used to work with him, but Lee took it on, and he was beautiful.
He did great.
Oh, it was awesome. So we lived there the whole next year while Lee McKenzie ripped the whole back off the house and completed the rest of Gail's plan. Sleeping in this cottage is about the most peaceful place I know, at least any place that's indoors.
So it's quieter than your house?
Oh, it's so nice back there. It's just so and they came back and they put in those little bookshelves there, and so the rest of it is just stuff that we dragged in from here and there, and then the loft isn't real tall, so we have the, just a little futon on the floor there. But that big old window, that window is why that cottage is as tall as it is, because we had the original design, it was like an 8-foot wall, and we went up to almost, we added about maybe 10 or 15 inches or something in order to accommodate that window in the gable up there.
So did you guys originally have such a steep pitch plan for the roof gap?
I think the roof pitch didn't change, just the height of the wall is all that changed, yeah. Okay. Yeah. Since then, we use it for guests and holidays, for a quiet retreat, other lots of good stuff. We've had a nephew stay in there for a whole summer. Our kids have come to stay. It's really been nice. We have all our, you know, we have Santa Claus comes to the cottage. Santa Claus doesn't come to the house anymore. And we sit out there in cold weather and have a fire. Good stuff. We can even go out there. It stays cool in the summer. I mean, not cool, but it's like 10 degrees cooler than the outside or in the house if you don't have the air conditioning on. It doesn't have air conditioning, but... And we never put in like the little wet bar thing and the gray water and the drainage and all those things, because there's things that you don't get to until later sometimes. So we still haven't finished dealing with the drainage in the back. You can see where it still pools up right there. The floor, we did put a rainwater tank behind. They did. I didn't do it. I took pictures. After about a year of just being lovely, the top layer of the floor turned all sticky and started coming apart. Lots of people have theorized why. Right now I have a big canvas drop cloth on it, and I am not thinking about it. And that original roundwood juniper trellis out front, the Banksia rose grew all over it, and it is doing awesome. And with that, I will turn this over to Kirby to tell you all about how it's really done.
That's wonderful.
All right, gang. Well, I'd like to introduce myself to you. My name is Kirby Fry. I live out near Elgin, Texas. I've been living there for almost 20 years now. Grew up in Houston, went to University of Texas A&M, got a degree in forestry sciences, basically learned how not to harvest trees or manage trees at Texas A&M University, clear cutting and genetic monocultures. And so then I went and served in the U.S. Peace Corps in Guatemala. I was in their agroforestry program in 90 and 91. Peace Corps is fantastic, I recommend it to everybody, but they break you up into narrow disciplines, and just as I was beginning to learn the language, well, it was time to go home. And so it was like, oh, you know. And then I came home and I heard a radio interview with this guy, Bill Mollison, and he was talking about sustainable design and permaculture, and he was integrating all these disciplines, and I was like, that's exactly what the Peace Corps was missing, because they didn't want us to congregate and speak English together, the Peace Corps volunteers, and so that's why they split us up into different villages. But really, all of these systems need to be going on together in unison to achieve the highest yield possible. The other thing, like in the Peace Corps, you're kind of always an outsider. My father was sick and my grandmother was getting sick, and it was like, I need to be closer to home with my family, speaking my first language. And so it just started to make a lot of sense to come back to Texas. And then there's this weird circuit that Peace Corps volunteers do where we go and we work as observers on the crab fishing boats on the Bering Sea. And so I was out at sea for 9 months over the course of 2 winters, and being on a fishing boat on the Bering Sea, it's like being in prison with the possibility of drowning. And so you're like, okay, I'm ready to go home now. You know, I got it all out of my system. So I came back to Texas, and it was then that I had learned about permaculture design. And this guy, Bill Mollison, was coming to teach at Fossil Rim Wildlife Center in Glen Rose, Texas. And I was like, whoa, what a coincidence. So I studied with Bill Mollison and Alan Savory over the course of about 3 years at Fossil Rim. And, you know, it was time to stop being an intern and a Peace Corps volunteer, start a career on my own, pay off my student loans, which I finally did, thank you very much. And came to Central Texas. I live in Elgin, Texas, where we have a lot of brick. There's a lot of red clay out there. There's Elgin Butler brick. There's U.S. brick and Acme brick out there. And so every single baseball diamond in Texas has our red clay in it from that area. And it's basically post-oak savanna. So what I'd like to talk to you guys about, and I really started out trying to be a landscaper, but landscaping and caring about the earth are almost two completely different things. It's like trying to ask a Jewish person to eat pork. It's like, no, I don't want to do that. And so I got into building instead. And the first house that I built was at Fossil Rim Wildlife Center. It was a straw bale house. It was a Nebraska style load bearing house. Never built one of those again. So basically you're building your wall system as you go. You have no roof over that wall system. So every time it rains, you have an anxiety attack. And it was also the time of the first natural building colloquium at Black Range Lodge. And I went there, but all I could do was worry about my straw bale walls getting rained on. So I was like, no, we're gonna do post and beam construction next straw bale house. And just for the record, straw bale, Mina, the file is Cobb Cottage and compressed earth block. So that's, so you gotta scroll down. Yeah, you're on it though.
I didn't know where it was, so which one? Okay, so it's down.
It'd be a file down there. There you go, Cobb Building Slideshow and Engineered Adobe Building. And, you know, I like straw bale because it's more modular. We did the math, like when we were building that Cobb house, if you wanted to do the same volume of Cobb versus one straw bale, it was like 9 batches of Cobb versus 1 straw bale. So 9 of these are throwing the tarp around versus like, oh, I beat you, you know? And they're like, haven't even finished batch 1.
It's a little less liquid.
You know, but the straw has its disadvantages. And one thing I want to reiterate to everybody, I'm over the materials debate. I'm about what works. I'm about what gets you up off the couch. If you want to ram tires with a sledgehammer and dirt in Taos, New Mexico, go for it. You know, just get up off the couch, go ram some tires. If you want to build cordwood, fine. If you want to build with pallets, I might stop you though. If you want to live in a shipping container, I might stop you though. But when it comes to natural building materials, they can all be done well. But I'm going to give you tonight some of my preferences. And that, they're just that, my preferences. I mean, in a perfect world, I would build a straw bale house that has straw bales on the east, north, and west side and an adobe wall or a cob wall on the south side. That way you get the insulation from the rising sun, the setting sun, the cold northern winds, but you've got the solar thermal capacity to absorb the southern winter sun. And that would be the adobe on your south wall. And when it comes to, well, I'll get into my preferences in a minute. That's definitely a part of this talk, but material debate aside, what we're really, thank you, Ken. I've been working in Wimberley. It took me an hour and 45 minutes to get here. We're on a site with no water, no power, 100% sun, no shade. No, I had a hat. It's like the sunlight splashing everywhere. And we're building a garden there. We're building a terraced orchard and a octagonal gazebo. It's like 8 sides. Are you kidding me? You know, like we get the same square footage with 4 posts. No, these people want 8 posts. Into solid caliche, so we're digging holes with jackhammer all day long. But what, as a builder and a designer, what we're really after is like the principles. Like, so I over the course of years, I've come up with some principles of natural building. And you can pick the material to go in there. So a natural building material is a material that's locally available and non-manufactured. So you know who lives in the most naturally built homes in the world? Is the Taliban in the Tora Bora Mountains in Afghanistan. Like caves created by God, you know? Like they exist untouched by persons. Then, you know, you get into like the Cobb Cottage Company out of Oregon. And they're really good. They're doing the rubble-filled trench, the mortar-together stone stem wall, cob walls, rough-hewn beams or rafters for the ceiling. But you know, they've probably still got doors and windows and a metal roof. Like, I live in a straw bale house, 432 square foot straw bale house. I've still got a concrete slab and a metal roof and glass doors. So I'm not trying to be a purist here. I'm about what works. What I'm really after is a house that pays you to live in it. And I'm about eliminating the possibility of waste. And so, like, if you collect your rainwater and you harvest all your gray water and your black water, you can run out of water, but you can't waste water. So when I brush my teeth, I leave the water running because I'm watering my garden, my orchard, and the yard. And right now, we're at the point where we're having to let water out of our cisterns so that we can get fresh rainwater in. So, like, imagine that, like, eliminating the possibility of waste. And then, well, how do you build a house that pays you to live in it? We'll build a duplex, you know? Lease out half of your home and pay for your mortgage that way. City of Austin used to have a lending program that supported median income families to buy duplexes. But definitely by collecting your rainwater, putting photovoltaic panels on your roof, possibly a solar thermal water heater on your roof, you know, we can get almost everything we need from our house to take care of ourselves and raise our families. But so the principles of natural building, they're not just about what materials we choose. I would say build small. Not too small. Like, I think Mina's house could have been bigger. With the Cobb Cottage, I mean, it was a...
But had to have a permit.
Well, I think it would have been worth it to pull a permit.
Yeah.
I mean, the crew size that we had, we probably could have built, we could have built a house 1.5 times that size for the same amount of effort to get those walls up.
And the same amount of cost, because
probably,
our square foot cost was really high, but that was because we didn't have all that many square feet. And it was
right.
Hard to, you know, when we were talking about that the other day, I figured out it was real hard to parse out, like, what was attributable to the cottage. And then, well, we had all that landscaping, and then we had fixing the garage and the breezeway, and it's like you can't.
Well, our cobblers were working for $10 an hour.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that's because I don't like to hire volunteers because I can't boss them around.
Yeah.
So if they make a little bit of money, I can, like, drive them really hard.
Oh, they worked really hard.
They did work hard.
Yeah.
So build small, proper orientation. And these are the basics. And so if you're in Central Texas and you've got a house that's maybe 24 by 48, you want the long part of the building to be facing south or south-southeast, basically, because this is the direction of the prevailing summer winds. And so you want that air to be able to pass through that house broadside. And then a yield of proper orientation is solar heating and cooling. And there's all sorts of really neat ways to take advantage of this. Now, if you go to the library and start looking into this, what you're going to find out a lot about is solar heating. We don't live in New Mexico or Colorado. The big issue here is humidity and heat. And so people want to build earthships in the heavy clays of Texas. I'm like, you're freaking crazy, man. Why would you want to be down in the mud? It's like, you want to be up in the breeze. Dealing, like, I have one little space heater for my house, and that's all I need in the winter, and I only turn it on for a couple of weeks out of the year. It's so easy to keep my house warm. Staying cool is the trick. And there's also, you know, like, one of my favorite devices is using the attic as a ventilation system. So I like the continuous ridge vent, the continuous soffit vent, and then you're inducting cool air and then exhausting hot air, and you get a convection current going on in there. Convection current. And then you really want to pre-cool the air around your house. So wrap around porches, deciduous trees on the east, south, and west side, maybe evergreen trees on your north side. And that kind of leads me to including comfortable indoor-outdoor living spaces. And I'm talking like screened-in porches. I really like the Texas ranch-style houses, and they usually have a wraparound porch on at least two sides. If you want to be comfortable in the afternoon, you want a porch on the east side of the building. If you want to be comfortable outside in the morning, you want a porch on the west side of the building. So if I had a screened-in porch, it would probably be on the north or east side of a building. But the east side of a building can be blazing hot in the middle of summer until about 11 o'clock or noon. And then we also want to build houses that orient us to the patterns in nature. So let's just say they orient us to nature. I lived in a house that faced due west. I mean, it was the worst possible orientation that they could have done. But what did I observe looking west every evening? Sunset. And what is the moon that follows the sun when it sets? It's the waxing crescent moon. And then what's right behind the waxing crescent moon quite often is Venus. And so it's like, oh, you know, you're watching that sunset every day, just baking you. And then occasionally you catch that waxing, or is it the waning crescent moon? It's getting bigger and bigger each day. And it's like, so you want it like, was it Paul, who wrote The Ecology of Commerce, Paul Hawkins or someone like that? And for Real Goods, or what was he developing in Colorado or California? They had 21 solar calendars in one building. And so when the sun would rise on the, what's coming up now? The autumnal equinox. When is that? Today? Tomorrow?
Tomorrow.
Yeah. And so when the sun would rise during the autumnal equinox, it would shine through a window, and they would have like some kind of icon or a tile mosaic on the opposite side of the building, letting you know what was going on in the environment around you. And you know, you got Machu Picchu and the pyramids of Giza and Teotihuacan and Angkor Wat, all of these famous ancient civilizations oriented their buildings to tune you in to the natural world around you. And I always thought, like, if you had a garden, you'd have a solar calendar that the shadow would be cast on what you should plant or what you should be expecting to harvest in the garden at that time. And then in the permaculture gardens that we're building, we're starting to plant our trees according to when they fruit. And so left to right, top to bottom, whatever, it's like, what's fruiting first of the year? I bet you guys don't know. Citrus. What's after that? Loquat. You know, what's after that? Plums, peaches, apples, pears, pomegranate, Asian persimmon. So your whole garden is this series of like, what's going on? It's like, oh, that just fruited. This is about to fruit. And so the information is embedded in the work itself. And so orient us to nature. Oh, and then that we rely on shapes that have inherent integrity. What do I just cannot stand flat roofs. Oh my God. It's like, what do all the hippies do when they move back to the land? They build rickety sheds with flat shed roofs on them with secondhand roofing metal on them. And they all leak, and 10 years later, the rafter beams are rotting. But if you had a steeper pitch roof, that has inherent integrity. And even if you have holes in that roofing metal, the water will just jump over those holes. And so use shapes with inherent integrity.
Well, in circular volumes, circular spaces are extremely efficient to heat or cool too.
Well, that's right. Like, what do animals do? The further north you go, the colder it gets. All the animals get larger and rounder. It's because a round circumference has inside of it the greatest amount of volume. And then when you go further south and it gets hotter, all the animals get skinny and lanky with big ears and long skinny legs because they're trying to dump heat. And so like for a cistern, you know, we use round cisterns because force is exerted equally on all sides. Now, I am not a big fan of living in round buildings. I'll just tell you that. I've built about 6 yurts, and they're just such a pain in the butt to like get cabinets in and countertops, and we end up building false walls so we can at least put the cabinets up to it. And round structures amplify emotions and dreams too. You got to be careful. Like, it's a great place for a Taekwondo or a Tai Chi class, but it's not always a great place to sleep. And so I'm over living in round structures, but for teaching and things like that, and dojos, round is fine. So those are my principles of natural building. So it's not just about materials. It's about what you do with these materials, how you use them. And like in permaculture design, you know, we're all about diversity, but diversity isn't just a factor of how many elements you have in the system. It's also the relationships between those elements. And so one of Bill Mollison's favorite definitions of permaculture design was that it's the science of assembling beneficial relationships. And so when we get into principles, it's not just about what material we use, but what we put it next to and how we assemble that and how, you know, how long it's going to last and what the yield of that system is going to be.
Appropriate materials.
Appropriate materials. Uh-oh, this is not erasing. Okay, then before I get into our little slideshow, are you getting close, Mina?
Yeah, I just figured out what I want to do because it's not going to flip with the arrows, but I think I can...
I know, I don't know what's up with those Macs.
Well, it's not that.
I bought a $1,400 MacBook so I could put slideshows on it, but I still haven't figured it out.
Well, I can show that.
Okay, so...
But we're going to go back to...
Kent, so I've built engineered adobe houses, I've built cob houses, and I've built the flexible form earthback house. Now, all three of these systems are adobe. And adobe is the parent material. Adobe is the mother of it all. And then, like, cob is really puddled adobe. And then, like, the compressed earth block, that's engineered adobe.
And stabilized, usually.
And stabilized. And that's part of what I'm going to talk about. And then you've got like earth bag, and they kind of have taken on the name of super adobe. But it's all adobe. It's all clay, sand, and straw. And sometimes it's lime and cement. So after building with all these different forms of adobe for the last 20 years, I prefer cob. It's my preference. Doesn't mean you can't make these guys work and get exactly the result that you desire, but as a builder, I prefer cob.
Kirby, could I insert something?
Sir.
Real quick? I'm Robert Morris. Mina has the building skills. I just stand around and watch. But I will say this.
You move around a lot, that makes a big difference.
Yeah. I will say this. I've always thought about cob as the old world equivalent of what you see in the Southwest as adobe, because cob is old world stuff. You know, you'll see it in England, like she was saying, cobbling things together. You'll see it in North Africa. You'll see it, you know, just lots of places in Europe. So that's all.
Well, so it's hard for me to not bash engineered adobe and earthbag, so I'll try to buoy cob. One of the things I like about cob, why cob, is that it's monolithic. And what do I mean by that? Well, what happens in an earthquake to an adobe house? It collapses and kills people. And so what do we have to do to adobe houses here now to meet building codes is you have to pour a concrete bond beam at the top of the wall system. It is a huge pain in the butt. I mean, like the engineered adobe house that we built in Smithville, it took us a week to form up the form boards and drop in the steel. And then we had to like bring in like 6 or 8 yards of concrete. And we're up there on these ladders and this giant boom going over the entire building. And we're blasting in all this concrete. Didn't have to do that with cob. The other thing I like about cob is that the surface is ready for plaster. The wall surface is ready for plaster.
So are you saying you don't need to rough it up or attach anything to it?
No, you don't. It's ready to go. Now with the engineered adobe, oh my God. That the engineered adobes come out, the sides are like as smooth as glass. And so it took three guys about 3 or 4 days going around our adobe walls with a hammer, and each block, each single face of a block had to have 9 to 13 chinks in it. And so we're just running around chinking all these blocks for like half of a week. And then the lime plaster still popped off of the north wall. And it could be because the house that we built The property burned down in 2011, and so the client wanted a fireproof house, which she got. But then the property burned again in 2015, and the heat may have like stressed the stabilized lime plaster, and it popped off of the north side of the building. And then in the Cobb, there's no lime or cement.
There can be, but there doesn't have to be.
Doesn't need to be. But with the engineered adobe, I wouldn't build engineered adobe blocks without 6% stabilized cement in it. And then when we do the earth bags, we generally stabilize the bottom few courses with lime. And then we're advertising workshops that are kid-friendly, and you've got lime on the job site. That is not a kid-friendly product. Lime is not friendly to anybody. And everybody I know who does a lot of work with lime, they have a lot of burns around their forearms because it gets in around their gloves. And they don't catch it right away, and so they're all, you know, have caustic burns on their skin. So the Cobb is monolithic. The surface is ready for plaster. No lime or cement is required in the Cobb mix. And then what I don't like about the earth bag is that it's not an ergonomic product. It's like we're running these continuous onion bags, and so you're standing up on the wall holding the bucket. It takes two people to deliver a cup full of dirt at a time, and you're walking slowly backwards on this wall, and you're shaking the dirt out of the bucket, and then you're like beating it and kicking it and tamping it, and your feet are like 6 or 7 feet above the ground. And then some of these earth bag builders, they're building these domes, and so they get up like 15, 16 feet, and they're standing on top of their wall systems, and then it takes like four people to get the material up to you. And that to me is just ridiculous. But the Cobb is very ergonomic. And the other thing that I didn't like about the engineered adobe is that on the engineered adobe site that we worked, it took 2 acres of land to mix and sift and compress the blocks. We had 28 18-wheeler loads of earth delivered to this job site. Anybody been to Bastrop on 71 and 95 where they got the buckies with like 26 mega pumps? That's where we got the soil to build this adobe house. And like 6 of the truckloads had too much sand in them and we couldn't use them. So out of like 28 truckloads, we got to use 22 truckloads. Well, it looked like a World War I battlefield when we were done. You could not do that in an urban lot. And the thing is that we had to make all the blocks at once. And the equipment to make the blocks must have cost at least $500,000. So we had 2 skid steers operating on the site, a giant metal frame for screening the material. One machine is just for mixing and integrating cement and water into the mix. Then you have to dig a pit under that, pick that material up with a skid steer loader, and take it to the block press machine. And then we printed out like 7,500 blocks. We were handling 1,200 blocks a day.
For
28 days. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so it's like after all that, I'm like, oh my God, like Cobb, you can stage 1 truckload of dirt at a time. You don't have to have all that material on the job site because the equipment has to leave and move on to the next project. Now with the engineered adobe, if you wanted to make that material off site, the cost of shipping would be phenomenal. And so Jim Halleck, who I totally respect and love, who does the engineered adobe, he was looking into like an off-site fabrication process. And I live near brick plants. I mean, I know we can ship that stuff out. I see the bricks going out on pallets every single day that I drive into Austin. But these are my reasons. Now, Cobb is slow. You can only go up so high. Kendra Welch is like, well, we can go up a foot a day. And I'm like, well, I would just like to see that, you know. It's got to be really dry, you know.
And I get that is because they're not mixing by hand; they're mixing in mixers.
Right. Well, and then I worked at Mike Carter's job site in Georgetown, supposedly like the largest Cobb house in Texas. Was that like 1,500 feet or 2,200 square feet? Or they're probably bigger ones now. It took Mike Carter 10 months to build those Cobb walls. And he swore he'd never do it again. But that's why I would do the Cobb wall on the south wall and the straw bales on the east, north, and west wall. Okay, Mina, yes.
So this is on the screen. I think so, thanks to the PowerPoint.
Thanks to David.
I have a clue how to.
Thank you, David. Are you going to be my?
I can hit your buttons if you want to.
Yeah, I'd love for you to hit my buttons. Oh, and
I can get arrow buttons real well.
Now, before, and thank you so much, Mina and David. So before we get going on this, because then we'll kind of be done after this, I do want to let you guys know that our nonprofit organization, Earth Repair Corps, we do volunteer perennial food garden installations. We're doing 10 this year. We've already done 45. And basically, we install conservation terraces, orchard, like fruit trees, asparagus, artichoke, blackberry, grape. We do support species, which are like cover crops, dynamic accumulators, native nitrogen-fixing trees, mineral amendments, drip irrigation, and mulch. And we're doing one in Bastrop. So this Facebook group, Texas Permaculture Design Projects, has the calendar. Earth Repair Corps has the calendar. It's earthrepaircorps.com. And we call these events Perma Blitzes. And the first Perma Blitz is coming up September 24th in Bastrop. Then there's it's this Saturday. Mm-hmm. And then there's one October 1st at the Austin Discovery School on basically like MLK near Imperial or Decker or whatever's out there. And then we're doing one in like October 29th in Maxwell, Texas, and just on and on and on. So,
and the place to register for those is through the Facebook group and or through Earth Repair Corps.
All right. Both of those have up-to-date calendars, and my phone number's up there, but I don't answer my phone and I don't check my messages. So text me if you want to get through to me. And I deliberately didn't give you my email because I can't get into my email. I'm very elusive. Okay, so the Perma Blitzes. We also teach courses in sustainable design, permaculture design courses. Ken's taken one, Brad's taken one, Gail's taken one, a lot of people here have probably taken them. We have those classes coming up as well. All right, so on to Mina's house. You've seen this picture. This is the beginning of the rubble-filled trench. What do I always get when we teach natural building workshops and people want to do the, or they don't want to do the foundation? They're like, this isn't natural building. Like, this is stone and concrete. I'm like, well, what did you think you were just going to set your straw bales on the ground? We're fixated on wall systems. And as a builder, I'm just offended by that. It's like, get over it, you know? You got to have good boots and a good hat. And if you live in the 20th century, you probably want running water and a drainage system and electricity and, like, you know, go play in that. What, you didn't get to play in a sand pile when you were a kid or something? There's a lot of hard work in building. Next picture. Okay, so there we're forming up. We're about to pour the concrete grade beam. I remember once I was at Animal Farm Permaculture Center working with Cass Van Worden, and Becky B was coming in from Arkansas to do a cob building workshop, and I'm doing a rubble-filled trench with Cass, and we're filling bags with sand, and that was going to be his foundation. And then the site flooded, and who got pegged for building a bad foundation? It was me. It wasn't Cass.
Because all the sand washed away.
Yeah, the sand washed away and the straw got wet, and I was the builder who said it was okay to build with wet straw bales. But what it was is that I let the client cajole me into building something that I didn't think was a good idea. And so if you want to hire me to build an earth bag foundation, I will do it. So you got to have, that. Now that could be a mortar and stone stem wall. Got no problem with that. Okay, next, Mina. And there it is poured. You've seen that. Next, Mina. Okay, so here we are mixing on a board. I do not like mixing on tarps. A couple of reasons. One, the tarps disintegrate. So after a day or two, there's holes in your tarps. Then they become trash and fill up landfills. If you've ever been on a real job site, you're not running around barefoot stomping in mud. If it's cold, you're not going to be barefoot. So you can't stomp on cob barefoot in cold weather. And if you do it for very long, your skin gets real thin and pink and shiny, and suddenly, you know, your fingertips and toes start to bleed, you know, because you've just worn the skin off your body. So I prefer to mix in a gas-powered mortar mixer that's got the big paddle on the inside, not the drum with the fins on it, because that gets bogged down by the earthen materials. So with Mike Carter, we had two giant gasoline-powered mortar mixers mixing cob like 7 hours of every single day. So that's This is out of sequence, Mina.
Oh, well, that's how it was in the file.
That is not the right file, but we'll make it work.
Okay, I'm sorry.
Okay, so just so.
Were you in the folder? Did you?
That's not the folder. That's just, anyway, just keep going. Keep advancing. There's the chimney being built. You can go. This is kind of when we jumped in after, and Mina kind of let on that her son Robbie had done the cobwall, but you did a bunch of it.
No, I didn't say that.
You did most of it.
He didn't lift a finger.
Okay.
Except he, all they did was dig the trench.
Well, I'm impressed that you got that far. Okay, next. Okay, keep going. Sand, clay. Now this clay, back up to the clay, basically our cob mix was one part sand, one part really awesome clay. And this was this grayish yellow clay that was pre-sifted for us. It was screened, so this stuff was like gold, man. If you've ever worked with clay that you have to manually screen, there's like two dudes doing that half a day, every day, throwing it against the screen, and half your material goes out to the trash pile. So, and this clay is light in color. A lot of clay.
Where did you find it? It's in Dripping Springs. It's a guy named Gene Glass that Hale knows, and Frank said it's the best clay, and Frank knows all about clay. And he has a whole thing set up where he dumps it through the screening.
Of course, he can only screen it like the dry times of the year.
Yeah, but he does a whole bunch of it, and then he sells it that way.
Phenomenal material. Okay, next. And so what we discovered, and I don't know how we stumbled onto this, but we got into this coarse granite sand, and even though we were using this really sharp masonry sand, if just the masonry sand and the cob, you can get cracks that go all the way through a 12 or 18 inch cob wall. But when we put that, and some of the chunks in that granite sand are like 3/4 inch in diameter, and those little rocks in there, I think, add a lot of strength to the cob. They don't let those cracks pass all the way through the wall system. And so we like to do a really good dry mix. So you do your, you know, half bucket of sand, half bucket of clay, half bucket of granite gravel, mix that up really dry. Then we try to get as much water into it as we can. And we measure very carefully how much water goes into a batch, whether it's in a mortar mixer or on the mixing board. You want to get that water in there as fast as possible, because that turns it into a slurry and it hypersaturates part of the mix. And then you fold the dry stuff into it to absorb that moisture at the end. The problem with the tarp is you're standing there with a misting pistol and a garden hose, because you can't pour the water onto the tarp because the water rolls off the tarp. And so you're misting it and flipping it and stomping on it and doing all this weird stuff. Okay, next. There's the mixing board, advance. Next. And then like, so just by how you dump the material on the board, Ken, where's Ken?
Yep, a little more water, we got it.
You began mixing it, so you pour out the sand, then you pour out the clay, next, Mina. Then you put the gravel on top. It's already in three layers now. So next, and then you just stir it up, next. And there's, and you know, talk about ergonomics. It's like, I don't ever want to see anybody walking around with a full bucket. I mean, I'd much rather carry two half full buckets. And so you always catch the dudes, the guys, overloading the buckets. I can carry that. Well, yeah, two or three times until your back goes out. And we're in it for the long haul. So you'll see that these are all half buckets. Like everything we do is always half buckets. Next. This is just an example. Like these are the lintels that go over the windows. They're two separate 8x8s that we mended together with those 2x4s. There's the chimney going up, next. Every day in the morning, we would pull our strings and use a framing square and some kind of like handheld chisel or axe, pickaxe. We called that the wall pecker after a while. And so every day we're up there with our strings and our squares and chipping away at the wall, and people come up like, well, did you use forms for that? It's like, no, we didn't. It's like, you got to think like the Romans and the Greeks, you know, it's like, how did they do all that stuff? You know, they had tripods and levers and fulcrums and all sorts of cool chisels and hammers. And it's like, you'd be amazed what you can do with your hands. Next.
See, I was trying to do it with, you know, dragging the boards across it like they showed in the other workshop when it's wet and like that, but you guys made it straight.
I did not realize that those lintels were put in rough like that and then debarked.
Right. And, you know, in hindsight, we might have debarked them on the ground. We used the power washer to take the bark off the cedar. And if you don't, it harbors beetles forever. Mm-hmm. And so, like our clients where we're working now, they're like, we want to leave the bark. And I'm like, there's some beetles in there, you know? And then you got to get a power washer that's over 3,000 PSI, and you got to get the little radial tip, because the tips that come with the power washer won't take the bark off. This radial tip, it spins a little beam of water, and then you get up underneath the bark and rip it off.
And then. Sanford stood up there on the ladder for hours and hours and hours.
Was he sanding
that? And he was going at it with some kind of little pick and sander and this and that, and he got absolutely, absolutely gorgeous.
Right.
But it was like...
Was that a part of the cost, do you think?
Yeah.
Well, we had three carpenters on the job and five cobbers, yeah. And when the cobbing was done, the cobbers had to leave and the carpenters finished up.
Okay. Carpenters make more than cobbers do.
Yeah.
And Kirby, could I ask maybe an educational question at this point? Now, you know, you've got this beautiful juniper there. You go to lots of places, roundwood and stuff, they do the beautiful juniper, and then they put a coating on it. Why would you argue against maybe putting a coating on it?
And isn't it usually polyurethane?
Yeah, and it looks nasty after.
Well, we use Pennafin and Total Wood Protection, and it's usually clear.
So you can't do that.
You can't. A lot of people like it when the wood grays up, but I don't. I like to see the original color of the wood.
Silver. Yeah.
Okay. Well, you don't have to treat it, but like we just built a hexagonal gazebo, and now we're building an octagonal gazebo, and we're normally, I don't like to stick wood into the ground because it's going to rot, but we're putting roofing cement on the bottom of those things. As a builder, if I want something to last, it needs some level of protection. Mm-hmm. Did we seal those? We might have. We put linseed oil.
We didn't use anything but linseed oil. Yeah.
But I don't like the polyurethanes because they flake when they start to fail. Yeah. I would use oils.
Another thing with planning projects overall too is the difference between, like, we did this whole cottage on an hourly basis with whatever it cost for them to do the work. When we came to the back of the house part, Lee McKenzie wanted to do it as a turnkey contract. And when he was working on it later on, I said, well, you know, what was his reasoning on that? Because it seemed like that he was do a lot of things cost him extra time that, you know, different things that, I mean, not like little changes, but just things happen. And he said, you know, I understand about that, but sometimes I want to work on something for a long time, and I don't want to have the homeowner freaking out about that.
It's worth it to him to do it right.
It was worth it to him just that he could do it his way. And at the same time, you know, so it's like it cuts either way. And so
if you work by the hour, you open yourself up to the client looking over your shoulder.
Yeah.
Next one. The all-important cleanup at the end of the day. If you leave mud on those tools, they'll all start to rust out. We actually had more women on the crew than guys at one point, which I thought was great. Next. Straw, next. Now, we did put this top plate on the wall system. Those walls are 12 inches thick at the bottom, 12 inches thick at the top. They only span 18 feet. We thought we were gonna need buttresses or pilasters. We did not. But we've got pieces of juniper buried in the wall system with that awl thread going through them. And then we set that top plate on the wall system because we're carpenters and our rafters have to land on wood, you know? And so then we cut our little bird mouth cuts in the rafters and they sit on that plate. And then we put like typical hurricane ties to keep it from lifting up in a wind. Another thing that drives me crazy about natural builders, like, let's build a reciprocating roof. I'm like, well, what is that? Like, it's all these sticks and they're crisscrossed and, you know, it makes a roof. I'm like, well, how do you roof that? Well, put a tarp on it, you know? And I'm like, that's just crazy. And so the first reciprocating roof I ever saw, they used a spray foam on it to seal it up. And I'm just like, so I have to build a roof that I know can be roofed. I'm not gonna build, not that mine have wanted a very conventional roof, thankfully.
Well, that's because, I don't know, I mean, metal roofs.
But you can collect your rainwater off of it.
You can collect rainwater and they don't get all torn up every time it hails.
Right. Okay, next. So I guess the roof is going to...
We use lots of metal.
So there's the chimney. There's the chimney going up. We bought these little 6-inch flues at Home Depot, those two metal things sticking out. And there's a little handle in there that you can't see it. And so, you know, every other day, we just give them a tug and pull them up another 8 or 10 inches and cob around them. And we actually mixed in this perlite stuff around the cob and didn't use any straw around the chimney flues. And the reason there's two of them is because the ridge beam sits in between them. So keep going, next. There we are, like, you know, carving out the chimney. And that's Sean Bonsall. He ended up on his back plastering the inside of that chimney like that. Okay, next. So the walls are getting tall now, very straight. You can see some of the, we did mortise and tenon timber framing up there where we had tongues going into notches with 3/4 inch oak dowels holding the thing together. Next. And I do remember having to lift the wall system up. And it must have been because of that window.
Mm-hmm. It was, because we didn't have inches for it.
And here we're getting ready to bring the ridge beam in. You can see the tripod off to the right. Next. You guys have seen
those windows were salvaged, by the way.
Salvaged.
We were working with what we had. So,
so the ridge beam is up. Next. I used all my old rope, my mountain climbing gear to hold these things up. Had to build a temporary base to hold one end of the ridge beam up. Next. There's the temporary mast, like, because the wall wasn't built yet to catch it. So that ridge beam does sit on the wall system. And there's that where the wall is oogling or splooging out. And see at the top, you've got to go carve that stuff every day. We might have been only going up 4 to 8 inches a day.
But okay. The ridge beam doesn't sit directly on top. It sits on wood.
There's probably a plate of wood in there that we built a little support for. Well, now one end it sits on a big old beam, but on the fireplace end.
On the fireplace end, it sits on top.
Oh, it had a collar tie in there that held it up.
Yes. Okay. Yeah, it does. Inside, not at the wall, but farther in the.
Okay, next. Yeah, that's just like how elaborate that was to get that thing up there. That's.
It was amazing.
It. Well, I was an Aggie, so we did Aggie Bonfire, and we were trained on how to carry logs out of the forest. You get the tallest people in front, the shortest in the back. You alternate, hands on top, hands on the bottom. You pick it all up.
I didn't do it for this because I couldn't figure out how, but if I do figure out how, I'll paste the videos together and put them up like on the DBL Facebook.
On the beam day? The Okay, next. Okay, there's the loft going in. Yellow pine frame for the floor.
Oh, buried in the wall.
Frank was mad at me for not using the juniper wood. I was like, this is stronger.
Kirby kept saying that the yellow pine was stronger.
It is. It's not as busy, too. There's the ridge beam. The rafters going up next. See, these slides are in a weird order. There's that collar tie. That's really what's holding the ridge up, Gail. But I think the end of the ridge is actually sitting on top. Mm-hmm. Hopefully it's got a little something spreading out. And here we are actually beginning to throw cob balls up to the wall system. Next, there's that collar tie going in. That's Sanford, he looks good there. And notice I put these pressure blocks on the outside of the wall system, so that created a stop for the plaster. And so we didn't have to worry about plastering up inside of the rafters. That's like a 12-12 pitch roof or a 10-12 pitch. Very steep pitch roof. Sheds water really well, but also kicks your employees off the roof really easily too. Okay, next. Oh, we did a little bit of straw clay up above the big window in the loft where you take straw and you dunk it into clay and then you shake all the liquid out. We didn't want like this big chunk of cob floating above the window. Because cob shrinks, you know, and it could just be like this big loose tooth up there. Next. There's one of our star mixers, Anna Bowman. Next. That's where the straw clay went. So you're looking at the form. The straw clay is behind that. You know, we took the form off after 2 or 3 days. It smelled a little funky, but it dried out real fast. Next. Those are the cob balls. See the 3/4 inch oak dowel there holding that thing together? No screws. Next.
Awesome.
Gravity's working for us. You've seen that. The reason why we have two sets of roofing straps there is to let air move between the roof deck and the roof straps. In hindsight, we could have just run those roofing straps diagonally, invented the drip edge, and had a ridge cap. This is probably a little bit more effective.
So this is what, since we were going to use that space up in there, what Kirby was drawing over there with the convection and stuff, this is a, kind of a mini version.
Right, and it's a vaulted ceiling on the inside. There's no attic. And the vents were behind the gutters. So there's the finished lintel. And one reason Thea Bryant hired me on to help her with her earth back houses is because of how we trimmed out these windows. Like, I will never bring plaster right up to the edge of a window. What do you do when you want to replace that window? You got to, like, cut back the plaster. So there's a little piece of trim, and we even left a little notch there for the plaster to return into. And then this sill is at, like, a 12-degree angle. And then that is a structural load-bearing lintel up there. It's about 6 inches onto either side of the cob wall. Next. There's the Smurf tube going in. The city would not let us run conduit inside the cob wall because they couldn't inspect it. And so they wanted us to run all of our conduit superficially on the outside of the wall system. So we took a hammer drill and our little straight claw hammers, and we used a 5-gallon Home Depot bucket to get that radius. Because the turn radius on the blue tube is 6 inches, and a Home Depot bucket is a 12-inch diameter. And so we embedded little pieces of wood back there, and the electrical came out really well in this house. Next.
How did you finish over that?
We just packed it with cob and let that dry and then plastered over it. Next. I thought we might see a picture of the lights. There's that collar tie up there and that finished reed mat for the ceiling. And it's got little bamboo stays to hold the reed mat up. It's pretty worked out really well. Next.
Okay, so Kirby, go back to that one. Not that this matters, but see this little post here? So this is taking the load down, and then that's carrying the load of the beams.
Right.
So it's not bearing on the...
And it's that not,
was where that beam is there is where you put those pairs of rafters of yellow pine and not the...
Right.
The juniper
more line. Structural... I forgot it. Your memory is better on this than I.
The purpose for all of that was to distribute the load.
Yeah, because you don't want a point load coming down.
And the cob shrinks and stuff like that.
Yeah, it's shrinking. It's not. It shouldn't be. With a good mix, it shouldn't shrink that much. But it's just that you don't.
Gail fine-tuned our mix for us. I think she had us tearing down sections of wall, pulling apart. On the first couple
the
days.
The granite sand worked really
The granite sand
yeah,
really
that
helped.
Decomposed granite. I can't remember if we got it from Custom Stone or where it was here. One of those places that sends big trucks.
There's the finished exterior. Like, that's where all those Smurf tubes were in there. You can't see any of that. No cracking. The lime plaster came out really well
really
on that cob
awesome.
Wall. Next. That's just more electrical. Next. We've seen that picture before. That's the Kiva ladder,
Yeah. The
finished fireplace, perfect looking shiny floor. Next, that's probably the end of it.
That's back to the
okay.
Other stuff.
Now, find me the engineered adobe. Oh, and now that's my daughter back there. And I always have to remind people that we're not just building houses, but we're like cultivating ourselves and our family in these houses. These aren't just designed to keep the water off of our heads. So there's one more folder in there that says engineered adobe, and we'll just fly through that.
While we're doing that, let me just say
there it is, David.
About our place. For me, it's like this beautiful cottage that you might experience in northern New Mexico. If you go out there, it smells like northern
That's
New Mexico.
The back of it. That's
it
the
feels
end of it.
Like it. You feel like you're in a
that's
really
not
wonderful
it. There it is.
Place when you're there. I mean,
that's
it's
it.
Just incredible.
Because of the materials.
Yeah,
you're close.
Materials.
Go forward.
Yeah. And some awesome building.
You're going up and down.
Yes. Earthen houses just feel very different. Very, very embracing. And
it starts out with a peaceful. Right before we pour the slab.
Well, the first night I ale spent in a straw bale house, I was just amazed at how quiet it was. That was the first the biggest impression that happened to me. So straw bales, super quiet, but in general,
there, no, to the top
as well.
There, there's the start. Oh, that's it. That's it. Yeah. So this is the engineered adobe house that we did in Smithville, Texas. Starting out with a foundation. It's like, yeah, we got adobe walls, but we still have a foundation with plumbing. Advance, please, Mina. There's your plumbing everywhere, wiring, cable, communications, heating, ventilation, air conditioning. Okay, next. Cement trucks coming next. Those are the embedded. Now this house, the client's house had burned down in the Labor Day fires of 2011. She didn't want any wood on the exterior of the building. So everything was steel or like hardy plank or adobe and plaster, next, or metal. And there we are, you know, doing the slab, next. These guys who pour these slabs, they're freaking amazing. They're out there in the middle of that slab with an aluminum scree board with nothing to guide them except their eyes and their intuition, next. That's like a 30 or 40 foot long bolt float. He pushes it out there, turns it, then it turns the bolt float the other direction, and he can pull it back, and that's how they float out the slab. Next. Just more stuff next. And then there's a gem shop next to Smithville. So in each of the four corners, we embedded like six gemstones. And then we bought a plastic horny toad and buried it in the center of the building, which is a New Mexico custom for luck. Next. You know, luck is a factor in things. Next. Just finishing out the slab. Advance. Working on the steps. Advance. Okay, now here's the World War I battlefield. So 22, 28 truckloads later and two skid steer. I mean, we tore this metal frame up. It's like in little fragments and slivers now. Dumping that material to screen it and sift it, next. And then you take it over to the mixer where they're adding water and 6% Portland cement, next. And that was Jim Halleck, by the way. There's the water going in, and that's where the cement comes in, next. And then you pick it up from the mixer, and this is the block press machine, next. And then it, you know, like it's 1,200 to 1,600 PSI. You make the block, the machine kicks it out, next. Sends it down the conveyor belt, next. Stacks of 10 high, you know, we're handling 1,200 blocks a day. With that Portland in there, my arms were white up to my elbows from the Portland. I just turned into a lizard practically. Next. There's the conveyor belt coming off. That black plastic back there, that's 7,000 adobe blocks. They're 10 by 14. They're the biggest adobes we could make. 3¾-inch thick. You add a quarter inch of mortar to that or slip, that makes each course 4 inches finished. Next. Window and door frames, next. There's Jim Halleck showing us, and Brad King and Chris Ornelas. We're about to run our first course of engineered adobe. There it is going down. We put a little bit of plastic down to protect the concrete slab, next. Here we are going up 3 courses high. I think this is when the electrical outlets went in. So you think you're going really fast, like, wow, we're up 3 courses. Oh, here come the electricians. Stop. They're going to be busy for 2 days. Go find something else to do. Electric conveyor belt to get the blocks over the wall system. This is a cavity wall here. This is the west side. So this is a 10-inch thick wall, like, I don't know, 6-inch cavity, and then a 7-inch adobe block with a, so it inducts air here, takes it up through the cavity wall, and then lets it out at a vent at the top of the wall system. Next. That's the same cavity wall. See that space there? That's so that the setting western sun doesn't superheat this wall and then release that heat out into the building at night. That's what we use to cut the blocks. Next. Here we are, like, the slip we put on, we're literally like, we have like ladles or pots that we're picking it up with. It's like thick pancake batter. It's almost more liquid than it is solid. And so you just slather it all out on the wall, and next. And then boom, you get 5 blocks up just like that. But not every day is like that.
But that mortar mix is essentially the same as the bricks themselves.
Yeah, but with no Portland in it.
No Portland.
That's just clay. That's just, yeah, it's, the exact same stuff that the blocks are made out of. Next. That's a big day when we got all the windows and door frames up on the south side. Next. Oh, now it's starting to look like some kind of fortress or something like that. These big steel pieces here, these are the story poles. And you can see there's a little block of wood and a string going across there that you go up in lifts, like 4-inch lifts. You move that every time you do a new course. Next. Now there's your concrete grade beam being formed up. It took like 5 guys a week to end like 12 sheets of plywood that we had to rip up into strips, which Jim Halleck took, and all that steel, and it was just like, oh my gosh. And that's 10 feet up in the air, and look, you can see the burnt forest in the background. And this property burned again last year in 2005, but the house did not burn. Next. That's like a 28 meter long boom, concrete flying everywhere, and then we're up there drilling in bolts for the top plate next. Oh, but that does look kind of cool, doesn't it? And all that electrical coming up through that concrete bond beam. Fortunately, we didn't have a single short. You can also see how we spaced some of the blocks at the top of the wall system to key that in. Next. And there we are putting up the prefabricated roof trusses. Next. There's the roof going up. I think that's Aaron Rawls and Brad King and me and Sean. And next. Next. The steel frame for the south porch. Next. Like I said, no wood on the exterior of the building. All hardy panel, hardy soffit, hardy plank. Next. That's the water wall. Even her insulation is fireproof. That's rock wool, which is making a big comeback. Next. We're almost done. Now there's all the chinks, like going around, like each one. There should have been 9 to 13 chips in each one of those blocks. Next. But the lime plaster looked pretty good when we finished. Now Jim Halleck did this lime plaster. He forgot to bid both sides of the wall, so he undercut me on my bid. But he only bid one side of the wall instead of both sides of the wall. But he ate the cost. He did it. Yeah. Next. There's the kitchen going in. Pretty conventional on the inside. Next. Okay, now this is our truth window. So we called Regal Plastics. We got a 1/2-inch thick 4x4 sheet of plexiglass, sent them a CAD drawing, and they used some kind of laser router, and they cut Texas out for us. You can see it. And each one of these screws represents a city. And since my favorite number is 9, there's 9 screws in there. And each one represents a city. Next. Oh no. Go to the next one. We don't get to see the truth window finish. Something's wrong with this. It's like...
Probably the file names do it in the wrong way.
Yeah. That's a recycled countertop. Was not cheap though. It's like polished glass and white cement and all sorts of weird composites. There it is. So there's the truth window. And we had a subcontractor come in. He's like, how did you get those adobe blocks behind that? Like, he didn't know the house was adobe. Like, why did you do that? It's like, no, the whole house is made out of this. And she's got the solar light, the light tubes going through the roof into the hallway. She's got 3 of those solar tubes. She's got a solar thermal hot water heater. Okay, next. And, you know, just a reminder, it's like you still got power and water. Next. Shower. She wanted all universal access for handicap access. Okay, I think that's it. That's not exactly... That's Coyote Creek Farm. There's the finished house. Not crazy about the color. No counting for taste, you know. But it's a bomb shelter of a house. And it's very nice on the inside. Got a wheelchair ramp on it, too. Okay, guys, I'm totally exhausted. Is it like 10 o'clock?
It is 5 minutes after 9.
We'll do it.